Hey guys, welcome to part 3 of the parking garage ceiling collapse VFX shot. If you haven't watched part 1 and 2, link is in the description. So let's talk about some of the render passes we have here. This is a small list of what I typically render out of 3ds Max. I think for this example, this is overkill, but we're probably just going to use the beauty pass, which is the RGB pass, the alpha, and then V-Ray shadows. I'm going to set up the extra text. Basically what that is an ambient occlusion pass, and I usually like to put two of them. One of them has a little bit of a tighter spread, and then the other one is a little bit wider, so we have the option to have wider shadows if we really want them, and then we can layer them in After Effects. So basically what I do is I drop down a V-Ray dirt texture and I set the radius to 10, and then I make another one and I set the radius for that one to 30, and just make sure the mode is set to ambient occlusion. Then I'll come into the V-Ray render passes and I'll create two V-Ray extra text maps. For the first one in the texture, I'll drop the first V-Ray dirt, which is the one with radius set to 10. And then for the second one, I'll do the same, but I'll select the V-Ray dirt that's set to 30 and I'll drop that in there. So that'll give us some options for the shadows. And again, we can layer these in order to make the shadows darker. But also don't forget, we have the V-Ray shadow pass, and that might just be enough. But it's good to have these just in case we need them. I'll go over to the V-Ray tab in the render settings. I'll make sure to separate the channels, save the RGB pass, save the alpha pass, and check the box to render to separate folders. I'm going to select our file path, name the file, and hit save. And then this box comes up asking us which render passes we would like to use. First, I'll switch it to the 32-bit float, select all of them, hit enable, and then press OK. I'm going to change the minimum subdivs to 2 and the max to 10, and that should give us a good picture quality. The shadows won't be noisy. Then I'll go over to the global illumination tab and change the light cache settings from still to animation. For something like this is not really going to take that long to render, so I can crank up these render settings and it's really not going to make too much of a difference, because remember, we're only rendering out one frame and then we're going to track that frame in After Effects because we don't have any parallax in the shot. So in that case, we could just use a point tracker. Then I'm going to go in and I'm going to solo the puddles layer, and I'm going to render that out by itself. We don't have to be that careful with this because we're going to just use this layer as a patch. So we're going to layer it on the floor, feather the edges, and put it underneath where the debris is. So we really don't need to be that careful. So here in our file explorer, you can see all the different render passes set up here, and we're ready to go to import them into After Effects. So here in After Effects, we're going to import all of our render passes. I'm going to take the RGB layer and I'm going to drop it into its own comp. And I'm going to throw the clean plate in there as well. I'm going to change the comp settings to match the length of the clean plate. One of the things that happened is when I imported the render passes, they came in as one frame in length. So we just have to right click, time remap, and create a still frame out of it. Same thing goes for the other render passes that I have in here. So I'll alt double click our pre-comped clean plate. You have to alt double click because it's in a pre-comp. If you just double click, you'll just jump into the pre-comp. So alt double click will load it into the window. I'll hit track motion and I'll track position, rotation, and scale. And I'll pick two points on the floor close to the location of where the 3D objects are in 3D space. So in this case around here, it's good. And I'll hit track. I'll make a new null object to link our tracking data to. I'll rename it tracking data. In the tracker window, I'll click edit target, select our null, hit OK, and then hit apply, and confirm you're applying to the X and Y dimensions. And now that null object is locked in that space, and we can link all of our render passes to this null object. I'm going to rename our RGB layer to concrete slab base layer, and I'll link that to the null object. Then I'll link our extra text layer to the null object as well. I'm looking at the extra text layer, and it seems like the shadows are not strong enough, so I'll just replace that layer with the V-Ray shadows layer. I'll switch the transfer mode for the V-Ray shadows layer to multiply, and I'll play with the opacity to get the shadows looking right. I'll also link everything to the null object so everything tracks with the shot. I'm going to drop a couple of color corrections on here to make sure that the CG matches the live action footage, making sure to match the black levels and also the brightness of the CG elements to similar elements in the live action shot. I'm also going to make sure the color matches between these elements, so I'm going to add more green to the CG elements to help them blend more with the live action. Here I'm actually just selecting the cement CG element, but for some reason Lumetri pulls in some of the other elements from the scene, so you can just ignore that, it's probably a bug, but I'm just going to widen out the selection so it selects the CG elements and not the vines. So I'll play with the tint and temperature to get the CG cement to match the live action cement. A little trick I use to get more detail out of the CG cement surface is to increase the contrast in the secondary so that it's only increasing the local contrast, which brings out more detail in the texture that's applied to the cement pieces. Then I'm going to add an overall color correction layer, also a glow layer, and a film grain layer. And I'm just going to do an overall color correction on the scene, as well as add a little bit of glow. Now I'm going to use a tight glow first, and then we're going to duplicate the glow, and then do a wider glow. I'm going to duplicate the glow layer, and I'm going to isolate this section here because that window in the background is sort of backlighting everything. Now, because I added a mask, I'm going to have to motion track that. But since we already have the tracking data, all I need to do is link the second glow layer to the tracking data. One of the good parts about having a backlight on a CG element is that you can use the glow to kind of have an overlap of the live action spilling over into the CG element. So the glow kind of backlights the CG element and it kind of overlaps it. So that helps it blend into the shot more. Here I'm just color correcting the ivy. So I'm selecting the ivy color and then making some adjustments here to make it blend into the scene a little bit better. So one of the things I'm noticing is that the lighting is a little bit flat on the CG element on the main concrete slab. I'm going to create another adjustment layer and name it Relight. I'm going to apply a curves adjustment to it. And I'm just going to mask out a certain section here and I'm going to make that darker. And then I'm going to feather the mask so it blends. And now we have a little bit more depth to that CG element. So I made it darker there because maybe the other pieces that are hanging are kind of casting a shadow there. And so that just helps with a little bit more depth to the image. Here I'm masking out the front cement section because I feel like it's a little bit too bright. So I'm just masking that so I can lower the brightness. I connect that to the track, but then you'll notice that there's a hard line up at the top, and that's because that's the top part of the adjustment layer. We actually have to move the adjustment layer up and then move the mask down so that we have a little bit of extra room on top so that when the camera moves around and the adjustment layer shifts around, we don't reach the upper limit of that layer and we don't get a hard edge to the color correction. So I'll turn on Film Convert to add some grain and also add some softness. And this is an overall softness for both the CG element and the clean plate. CG elements just in general are really sharp, and so to help them blend, it really helps to blur them. Underneath the Film Convert softening, I'm going to add an unsharp mask to bring back some of that detail. And basically what that's doing is just limiting the fine detail that we often see in digital things, such as CG elements and footage from digital cameras. But then the unsharp mask underneath it adds some detail back, but stops the high frequency detail from showing up. We need to put the Jeep on the left in front of everything that's in the shot. So I'm going to duplicate the clean plate, put it on top, and then lower the opacity so we can actually see what areas we need to worry about. So this area around here, I don't really need to be too precious about because that's not overlapping with anything. But where it is overlapping, that's where you need to be careful and make sure your mask is accurate. I'm going to right-click on the mask and hit Track Mask, and then I'm going to track it forward so I don't have to roto this by hand. Always good. I'm just going to add another relight layer here. I'm going to darken the cement pieces that are on the ground because I'm feeling they're too bright. I'm going to drop our puddles layer on the ground here, and I'm going to adjust the opacity. Now, one of the things I ran into was that those puddles on the right are a little bit too bright, so I dropped the opacity to 15 so that they're not so glaringly bright. And then I'll duplicate the ground layer and mask off this section here so that I can control the opacity separately from the other section on the right, and I can match the exposure between the two. And I'm actually going to bring in this section here because I feel like that's a little bit too much off to the right. And if I bring it in, I think it looks better. Then I'm going to darken some of the floor layers so that the cement looks like it's wet. Just a small touch there to give it that saturated concrete look. And of course, make sure you link the puddle layers to the track. I'm going to adjust that upper relight section on the cement slab there. And now I'm just going through and doing some fine-tune adjustments just to make everything look good. And that's it. We finally made it through. On a side note, I actually did this project in Blender as well, and I actually really like the way it came out. Some of the tools in Blender are really nice, and if you guys want to see how I made this in Blender, leave a comment and let me know so that I can make those videos for you. There are a few gotchas and things here and there and a few plugins that you might need to get, but the great thing about Blender is that the plugins are extremely cheap. We're talking like $5, $10, and a lot of them are free. In fact, some of the ones that I used to create this are free at the time of this recording, so I was able to leverage those tools to help out with making this. So if you guys want to see a Blender version of this instead of 3ds Max, let me know, and I'll go ahead and make those videos for you guys. Stay tuned next week because we're going to cover how I created this The Last of Us title sequence, which is inspired by the title sequence in the trailer. It's not going to be exactly the same because we're just going to use After Effects, but it's close enough, and you get some really cool techniques in there that you can apply to your own title sequences. So stay tuned for that next week, as well as some other VFX shots that I have planned. And as always, if you like this video, please subscribe and hit the like button so I can continue bringing more of these videos to you guys. Thanks for watching. This is Paul Dovecchio, and I'll catch you next time.